Edwin Canastracci here, drinking some cognac in the afternoon. Note the proper glass. I'm a classy guy. You know, one of the things that got me into cognac and, you know, brandy overall is I'm a big fan of the Hammer horror films. And the Hammer, you know, British horror films from the 60s. And usually my favorite scenes are when, like, it's Peter Cushing or someone like that, and he's with some other British guy, and they're in a drawing room somewhere in some nice big house, some big estate in the country, and they're having some sherry or brandy. It's usually sherry or brandy, and they're discussing, like, the monster, you know, but they're very civilized about it because they're English gentlemen. I heard that there's some trouble in the village. Apparently, there's some sort of monster terrorizing the people there. Yes, the people there say it's quite the abomination. Yes, quite. Shall I freshen up your drink? And then, you know, they proceed to talk about how they have to stop the monster. Drawing rooms were kind of like the man cave of the old English gentlemen. So, like, you know, that's where they want to kind of get away from their wives and drink brandy and sherry and discuss politics and, you know, monsters. And it's really just an excuse. It was just an excuse for them to get pissed on brandy and sherry. Yeah. But that's what I love about the Hammer horror movies. They're very boozy. Very boozy. Oh, by the way, I'm talking about the Bee Gees. Edwin Canastracci here talking about the Bee Gees. Yeah, the Bee Gees. Bet you didn't see that coming. So there you go. One, keep throwing curveballs at y'all. So yeah, it's the afternoon. Sunday afternoon. And I am drinking cognac and talking about the Bee Gees to myself, to a computer device. But it's alright, because I know a few people are going to be watching it, so it's not too weird. I've been on a really big Bee Gees kick, as Facebook friends know. There's two reasons I've gotten onto this Bee Gees kick. It's not actually that documentary that's on HBO. That I did watch that for the first time like two nights ago, but I was already on this kick without watching that shit. What happened is a buddy of mine on Facebook, a good Facebook friend, Jimmy James Swartz. There you go, Jimmy James Swartz. Cool name, Jimmy James. He's a big Bee Gees fan, and there was a song that he posted like a month ago on Facebook, and it just, like, it was a Bee Gees song from the early 70s, and it blew me away, and I hadn't heard that. I had a couple of their 60s albums. I had Idea, Odessa, and Cucumber Castle, and I had from the 70s, all I had from the 70s was Main Course and the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. That's it. So I really didn't have too much Bee Gees, you know? So, but he posted this song, and I was like, wow, that's really amazing. And I remember how much I did love those late 60s albums I have. And so I got that, and then before you knew it, I fell down very quickly down a Bee Gees K-hole, and I got Bee Gees first and horizontal, and before you knew it, I was buying up all their 70s stuff. And at the same time, my wife had watched that Bee Gees documentary, and she had gotten on the kick, and she told me that, you know, I should really be listening to their late 70s stuff too and give that stuff a chance, plus an early 80s album, Living Eyes, that she really liked a lot and thought I would dig. So I did. So I got all that shit too. So this is like a really fresh kind of review. Normally, a lot of the stuff I review and talk about are albums and bands I've lived with for a long time. Now, the Bee Gees, as an act, I have lived with to a certain degree, and I'll explain my backstory with the Bee Gees and how they're kind of an important group in regards to my childhood and my upbringing. But in terms of their whole discography, I was not an expert. But, you know, I really did a crash course, and I'm excited about them now, and the albums are fresh in my head, so I'm going to do it. Even though I'm sure my opinions about a lot of these albums might change in the next year or two, I'm in the mood, so let's do it. Let's talk the Bee Gees, man. Let's talk the Bee Gees. they're not the band that a lot of you think. Yeah, you know, they're mainly known in America and the States for their disco era stuff, which even that even some of those so-called disco albums are not entirely disco. But that's the rep they got because of, mainly because of Saturday Night Fever and a couple other disco oriented hits that they had in the late 70s. So that's how they're mainly known in America. But, you know, in England and in Australia, which is where my wife's from, Australia, they were already a very big group before that, going back to the 60s, where they were more of a Beatles-type pop rock band. Definitely more in that vein, British Invasion-style pop rock. And they got very experimental, even psychedelic a bit in the late 60s, like a lot of bands. And short of the ballads, the one thing that kind of holds all the different eras of the Bee Gees together is that they always wrote these really beautiful, lush ballads. So that's something that you get kind of in all the eras. So that's like that's really the soul of the Bee Gees is are those ballads. But in terms of the other music stylings, from psychedelic rock to even a little country here and R&B, you know, funk disco, they even a little bit of synth pop in the early 80s. They did a lot of different styles. Very eclectic band that could adapt with changing times of the 60s, 70s, and a little bit of the early 80s, and then not so much after that. They couldn't really adapt. But they did a pretty good job adapting in the 60s and 70s, no doubt about that. And they're not just the band you think they are. There's a lot more to them than Saturday Night Fever. Not that that's not great shit, too, but we'll discuss it all, and I will discuss that album as well. The thing about the Bee Gees is some of my earliest childhood memories, my earliest memories, period, are Bee Gees or Saturday Night Fever related, because I was very, this is like the early 80s, like 1980, are some of the first memories I recall. You know, I'm just like a very little guy, little toddler, and I recall some of my first images, I recall looking at Saturday Night Fever trading cards. It seems funny watching that movie now to think that there were trading cards for it, because it's a pretty gritty R-rated film. I mean, they dropped the C-bomb, there's some like near raping going on and gang banging. A guy falls off a bridge and dies. Spoiler alert. it's a dark film. It's gritty. It's like Mean Streets with disco dancing. That's essentially it. It's like Mean Streets with disco dancing. And it's funny to think that there were trading cards that little kids had of it. But hey, that was the crazy late 70s, man. That was crazy. The crazy 70s and early 80s. The baby boomers, they were very loose with us. And as a result, I think Generation X is cooler than the younger generations. Sorry, just deal with it, all right? Because our parents didn't coddle us. You know, we were able to watch cool things, and it made us know that the world was a fucked up, crazy, funky place where there was sex and violence out there and trouble was around each corner. So we were prepared for it, man. We were prepared for it. Maybe not as prepared as the generations before us, but definitely more so than the ones under us. I'll tell you that. And so we were introduced to a lot of adult shit because us, our crazy hippie baby boomer disco dancing parents didn't really, they were like, hey, this is what I like. I'm not going to change what I like just for my kids. You know, kids are going to have to learn to like what I like. You know, so that was kind of the spirit, you know, and that was the thing. Like a family film, like National Lampoon's Vacation was like a family film in the early 80s, even though it's R-rated and, you know, there were tits in it and the, you know, F-bomb was dropped, you know, the Blues Brothers, all that stuff, sharks eating people, Jaws, Nazis' faces getting melted off by the wrath of God. This is the kind of shit we saw as kids. And you know what? I don't feel like I was traumatized because of it. In fact, I feel like a lot of people in my age bracket deal with shit a lot better than younger millennials and the kids underneath that seem like a wreck, you know? Not that I won't be the older guy shitting on the younger kids. I know some of you are cool, but a lot of your generation, you need to get some balls. Life is rough. Just deal with it, man, and enjoy it. Enjoy it. There's fun there, too, man. There's fun. So anyway, so that's my childhood. Looking at Saturday Night Fever trading cards and shit, and Grease trading cards, and of course, Star Wars was everywhere. And I remember my mom had the Bee Gees' Greatest Hits on vinyl, and she played that all the time. This was like a double record. I remember the gatefold was cool. It had big pictures of all three members, kind of like the Beatles kind of stuff. And it had all their hit songs from the 70s, from the late 70s stuff. And she played that album a lot. So my first earliest childhood memories are the Bee Gees, that Bee Gees' Greatest Hits. And so those songs, all those songs from the late 70s, and that included Saturday Night Fever songs, that was a big part of my childhood. And even Saturday Night Fever, I watched that movie a lot as a kid, you know? So, and I think I turned out all right. But anyway, but that's a subject to debate, I guess. And that was a big part of my childhood. And it just RSO, that RSO label, with the little red cow. I used to see that all the times on the records my mom bought and a few she bought for me, because it was like the Grease soundtrack and that Bee Gees Greatest Hits, but also like the Empire Strikes Back and Return Jedi soundtracks were also put up by RSO. And I didn't realize until I watched that documentary two nights ago that was Robert Stigwood's company. That's the RS. He was the manager for the Bee Gees, as well as Eric Clapton. He was Big Shot British manager. And he created this record label specifically so he could put out like Bee Gees and Eric Clapton albums and make some money. And he originally worked for Brian Epstein's company, but then he left and went off and started his own company. And that's RSO. So that was very interesting to know that this label that I used to see all the time as a little kid. It was like that in Casablanca. RSO and Casablanca was like the two I used to see so much as a little kid. And Robert Stigwood was really important. He's like one of the most important people in terms of the Bee Gees' career. And he also produced Saturday Night Fever. I didn't know that whole project started essentially as a project so that he could produce something exploiting the disco craze and get his band the Bee Gees to do music. Like, that was kind of the genesis of that movie. It's amazing that movie has such high quality and it's so gritty and real, considering that the genesis is like so cynical and it's all about just synergy. But hey, whatever, sometimes synergy will lead to a classic great film. And that's the great thing about the late 70s is commerce and grittiness were combining. And Saturday Night Fever is like all about that, grittiness and commerce combining. And so that was all very interesting to find out. That digression aside, so the Bee Gees, especially their disco incarnation, was a big part of my childhood. I knew all about them. I remember that horrible Sgt. Pepper Lonely Hearts Club Band movie. Even as a kid, I knew that was shitty. And of course, that hurt them in their career and the whole disco sucks movement. And you know, you could watch that goddamn documentary. I'm not here to talk about the broad strokes. We're going to get niche here. We're going to talk about the kind of Bee Gees shit that Frank Marshall ain't talking about in his documentary. That's right. We'll talk about some of that shit, but we're going to talk about the albums that they ignored. All right? So if you're deep in the Bee Gees, or you want to get deep in the Bee Gees and find out more about them, then stick around, grab a drink, because this is going to be a long one. They had albums before the Bee Gees first. Their first album, 1967. They had Australian albums. But I don't have any of those albums. Maybe my wife can hook me up with some with her family next time she or the two of us go back to Australia, because I would like to hear them. But I can't review them because I haven't heard them. But what I can talk about, and because the Bee Gees discography for the most part is somewhat new to me, I want to check Wikipedia and make sure I get all this shit correct. So the first album, 1967, Bee Gees first. Even though it's not really their first, but it is their first international album. The first one they did in the UK, which was designed for both the UK and the US market. One thing I'll just say as a backstory is the Bee Gees were born in England. Their childhood was, for the most part, in Manchester. Then their family moved to Australia, and that's where they spent a majority of their adolescence and started playing music and stuff and started playing gigs and putting out albums. But then with the advent of Beatlemania and the British invasion, their father, who was managing them and the Bee Gees, decided, yeah, let's go to England, try to exploit that. Let's try to get hooked up with the Beatles management. And they did, actually, because Robert Stigwood was working for Brian Epstein's company at the time. So they pretty much were reffed by the Beatles management. Talk about, you know, this hitting the bullseye right out of the gate. But they had the goods, that's why. They were talented guys, you know. Barry was very good looking, very talented, all three brothers, great voices, and you know, they had the goods. They've been playing since they were little kids, so they knew what they were doing. They were very well seasoned performers, even by the time they got to their first album, because they already had Australian records and been playing for years since they were kids. So they had the goods, and you'd have to be an idiot not to want to rep the Bee Gees. So they repped the Bee Gees, and all their albums from the late 60s and even very early 70s are just credit. The producers, for the most part, always said it's Robert Stigwood. I don't think he actually produced. I think he just, you know, had his name in there. Probably came in and said, yeah, that's a good track. You know, that sounds good. Good work, lads. But I think essentially the Bee Gees were even at this early age, producing themselves, which is very, very impressive. And so Bee Gees first. Now we're going to talk about the albums. We're finally going to talk about the goddamn albums after one more sip. So their first single, it's on this album, New York Mining Disaster, 1941. What kind of title is that for a pop song? Man, it's awesome. New York Mining Disaster, 1941. Man, this is like people were trying new shit. This is post Dylan and the Beatles, so they already kind of broke the door open that you could sing about different shit. But I feel like the Bee Gees took it to another level right out of the gate with the first album. Their lyrics are really great. They're great. They're weird. They're idiosyncratic. They're different. And they always write about different stuff. You know, all the brothers, but especially gotta give credit where credit's due. And I know Robin and Morse were not like this. But it's Barry. Barry's the guy. Barry's a genius. He's a genius songwriter. He is the Brian Wilson of the Bee Gees. He's the oldest brother. He's the last man standing. And he wrote most of their, not all, but most of their great songs. And the man is an amazing, amazing talent. I put him up there, Paul McCartney and Brian Wilson. He's one of the great pop composers of the 20th century. And you're going to hear a lot of Barry Gibb genius gushing on this video. But all three brothers are very talented. Just like the Beach Boys. All three were very talented. You know, Dennis was also a really good songwriter. And Carl, you know, could knock out a good tune too. And they all had great voices. But yeah, but Brian obviously was the full-fledged genius of the band. And likewise, I kind of feel that's the case with Barry Gibb is the genius of the Bee Gees. So, but I do think Robin and Morris are both very talented. Morris especially is very underrated, and we'll get to some of his shit later on as he grows as a songwriter and singer. Anyway, but this is a great album. Holiday, such a great song. I love Holiday. Love that song. Every Christian lion-hearted man will show you. That's such a 60s Bee Gees kind of title. That's the thing you're going to learn about the Bee Gees. Not only are they big Anglophiles, they get very into the Britishing. Maybe not quite to the... Almost, they kind of give the Kinks a run for the money on who's the biggest Anglophile British band of the late 60s. They really get into it. They really get into the id of being English. And very interesting lyrics, as you can see. And New York Mining Disaster, of course, that's great. Cucumber Castle, which might be an album title later, but it's a song here. To Love Somebody. Oh, beautiful, beautiful soul song. And it's right out of the gate with this first album. They're showing that they do have a side. Even though for the most part this is very white music. They do a song like this, which I believe this was one that they were thinking of Otis Redding when they were writing it. This is a soul song. It's a beautiful soul song. And they sing it in Barry's voice. Amazing, amazing right here. He's singing, this white British kid is singing amazing soul music. And that's one thing, too, that distinguishes them. It's very easy to listen to the Bee Gees early stuff here and just say, oh, they sound like the Beatles. But I think one thing that distinguishes them is, A, I think they're actually a little weirder than the Beatles. And that's saying a lot, because the Beatles were getting pretty weird in 67. But also, they had a little more of a soul influence. And you didn't hear it. You heard a little of that in the early Who and the Rolling Stones, definitely. But you didn't hear that so much in the Beatles or the Kinks. And that's something that distinguishes the Bee Gees a bit, is that they have this soul side, that they're into soul. And you can hear it, especially in a song like that. That's beautiful. This whole album's a great album, great debut. I would describe it as psychedelic pop rock with a streak of soul going through it. You can also hear a lot of influence. It's funny, before I even watched that documentary, I was telling my wife when I was listening to these first couple albums, I was like, this sounds like Oasis was into like early Bee Gees. And sure enough, when you know, Noel Gallagher was in the documentary talking about how early Bee Gees were influenced on Oasis. Again, people would hear Oasis and just immediately go to the Beatles. And yeah, obviously the Beatles were an influence, but if you're really into the British Invasion, it's kind of like any music you're into. If you're really into country or R&B or metal, you will hear the differences and nuances a casual listener wouldn't. So if you're really into the British Invasion, you can hear the subtle differences of what makes the Beatles, and the Kinks, and the Bee Gees. And you can kind of hear all those differences a little bit in Oasis. And so like to the novice, Oasis would just sound like they just listened to the Beatles. But if you hear a little bit, I hear a little bit of the Bee Gees. I hear a little bit because it's a little more that British lads doing soul music thing, which there's almost a touch of that to Oasis. And it's probably a Manchester thing too, because both bands came from Manchester. And also the Smiths, I hear a little bit of some of the stuff in the late 60s and early 70s almost sound a little bit like the Smiths at time. And the Smiths were also from Manchester. So I think there is a Manchester thing going on, some kind of tough but romantic soul of a Manchester lad. You kind of hear it in early Bee Gees, the Smiths, and Oasis. You kind of hear that. And I love it. I love that. I like that Manchester soul. I'll call it the Manchester soul music. I like it. You know, tough lads that sing a hard-on-sleeve ballad, but then they'll cut you afterwards if you fuck with them. Anyway, so that's great. Great album. Great debut. Then we get to 1968, Horizontal. Even better. Man, great second album. Shows their growth. This is even more psychedelic in places. I call this psychedelic British pop perfection. I love this album. World's a great song. Lemons Never Forget. Man, this song is so great. You would never think a song called Lemons Never Forget would be a good song, but it is. The Bee Gees make it a good song. It's weird, but it's good. It's dark and, oh, it's great melodies, and Barry sounds great on it, and man, it's a great song. I love Massachusetts, of course. That was one of their, well, I say of course to hit people, but people that are in America might not even know so much. Although this song did chart, it broke the top 20 in America. Massachusetts, I think it was their first song to break. Maybe it was the mining disaster. I don't know the exact chart positions. But Massachusetts was a hit, and a big hit in the UK. I believe it was a number one hit there. And it's an amazing song. Robin's vocals are amazing on this song. One of his best vocal performances. I love Massachusetts. It's a soaring pop masterpiece. Earnest of Being George, another song, sounds a little bit like Oasis, especially when they get more psychedelic. The title track. Whoa, is that title track great? It's dark and cryptic. And that's the Bee Gees had a dark side that doesn't get discussed a lot about. But this song's all about like laying under a tree and like thinking about death and embracing it. It's like a really deep, heavy song. And the production, the atmosphere. This is the thing, too. And this is the Bee Gees, you know, are producing this album by themselves, essentially. Them and Robert, who I don't know. And correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think he really produced. I think he just came in and went, that's good, lads. That's good. Keep it up. The Bee Gees were, like, these young men producing. Like, even the Beatles weren't producing themselves. By 68, they were more involved in the production. But they still had George Martin. But I think for the most part, the Bee Gees are pretty much producing themselves here. And from what I hear, it's largely Barry. At least that's what Robert said in interviews. It's amazing production. A lot of atmosphere. I love this song. I love this whole album. It's great. Let's keep moving. Okay. 19... Same year. God damn, people used to knock shit out back then. It wasn't like, oh, I'm going to take my time. I'm going to take 15 years to make an album. Like Axl Rose. These guys knock out two great albums in 1 year. 1968. And this album is maybe even a little bit better. Idea. Amazing album. A lot of hits on this one. Amazing album. Man. I would say with this album, they move a little away from the psychedelic stuff. They're moving a little away from psychedelia. Not entirely, but a little bit. Which makes sense because that's what a lot of people were doing in the 68. And no one will ever say the Bee Gees did not follow trends. So they were moving away from the psychedelia a little bit and focusing a little more on just their pop sensibilities. And, you know, Barry was still growing as a songwriter and was knocking out some amazing shit. Apparently the UK version didn't have I've Got a Message to You. Okay, so I'm going to look at the US one because that's the one I got. So Let There Be Love. Oh, man. Amazing. You know, Barry sings and then Robin comes in and it's like, oh, full on. Heart on sleeve. You know, sometimes, and we'll talk more, well, we'll talk about Robin's voice and Robin a little bit later. But I'm going to get back to this Robin thing. But anyway, but Robin comes on and it's like, oh, it's pageantry. It's pageantry. If you're talking about sappy pop songs, this is the equivalent of a sappy pop song, what Judas Priest is to metal. Like Rob Halford brings in the pageantry to metal, you know, and he makes it, like he goes all the way with it, you know? He makes it as metal, and regal as possible. And, you know, Rob Halford, also an Anglophile, which I learned from reading his book. You know, he's all into, like, the Queen of England and shit like that. So there's this aristocratic thing going on. And the Bee Gees had that too, you know? Even though they were, like, middle-class Manchester people, if even that, and then moved to Australia and then came back. So they weren't, definitely not aristocrats, but God damn it, they wanted to be aristocratic. And they really embrace it. Like Robin's vocals, oh my God, it's like the queen is coming in to sing you a song. Indian gin and whiskey dry, great kind of, I'd say kind of a rock tune. And this Robin, sometimes he has this hard on sleeve romantic voice, but sometimes he can get a little more soulful and bluesier, and this is a song where he does that. It's also a little kind of folky and country too. It's just it's kind of like everything combined. But I love Indian Gin and Whiskey Dry. Great song, great lyrics. I've got to get a message to you. It hit in the U.S. and in the U.K. and an amazing song. This is another song that I think is kind of a soul song. So it kind of sets up where they might go in the 70s. Because it's pop, it's lush, but there's something very soulful about it. And to me, this is like, you know, what you'd call blue-eyed soul. But, you know, I don't really like that term. Soul music. I don't give a shit what color a person's skin is, you know? And this is like a soul song. It's a beautiful song. One of their greatest songs ever. And Robin and Barry, again, just like the first track, they are trading off vocals. And, man, their vocals, it's amazing. I mean, Barry is my favorite singer in the band. I'm just going to say that right now. I prefer his voice to Robin's, but they both have great voices, and I love when they work together with them. But, man, they are such a great song. When the Swallows Fly is a great song. I Started a Joke, of course. Probably the song that's most known these days from the 60s is this song. Robin's vocals are... This is kind of where he's sometimes a little too much for me. Sometimes Robin, with that puppy dog, heart sick, love sick vibrato thing he does. I can roll with it for a little bit. You know, it's nice as a contrast to some of the other shit, the more, you know, funky Barry stuff. I think Barry's like kind of a little funkier singing, which makes a lot of sense with where they would go in the late 70s. And Barry's just a little more straightforward, and I can kind of grasp it and relate to it more as a lad. You know, that's all I could say. Whereas Robin sometimes is like, I can't entirely. I don't feel that way necessarily. You know, I feel the way Barry feels, but I don't know if I feel this way, Robin. You're in your own little sad castle somewhere. Floating off on a cloud. But, you know, it's a thing. It's very unique. And I can appreciate it, and especially in small doses. And this is a lovely song. Really great lyrics. But it's probably my least favorite on the album. And I'm not just saying that to be counterculture, because it's like the most famous song. But, it's all right. It's a nice little ditty. But, you know, man, if you think this is all what the Bee Gees are about in the 60s, you haven't dived into the Bee Gees. But it's a nice little song. It's a great album, great follow-up to Horizontal, kind of moving a little away from the psychedelia and focusing on their pop ambitions, but some great shit. I love it. And then we get to my favorite Bee Gees album. That's right. This is my favorite one. And it came out in 1969, and it's called Odessa. Odessa. Let me drink a little more cognac, because I want to be a little drunker when I talk about this one, so I can tap into its mystical vibes. Okay, I'm not a big fan of concept albums, and this isn't a concept album. They were considering it. They were considering turning the title track into a whole big epic thing, and it'd be the whole album. But they didn't do that, and I'm glad they didn't, because I'm not a huge fan of concept albums. You know, like I said, I'm not a huge fan of Sgt. Pepper, as a lot of you know. I don't dislike it. It's a good album. It's just my least favorite Beatles album. And, you know, the whole Beatles Gone to Broadway thing, which is something I've said that some people say, like, why are you always saying that? Like, something's gone to Broadway. This is not Broadway, this album. It's different. It's closer to the weird side of ambitious albums. I would say like Piper at the Gates of Dawn or the Beach Boys Smile. Actually, I would probably connect this most with the Beach Boys Smile. It's a trip, and there's a lot going on with this album. When this album came out, it was a double LP, and it was burgundy velvet. Like, the actual album cover was like patent and like burgundy velvet, this is like the record I would most love to get. A lot of these early Bee Gees albums are hard to get on vinyl. But man, I would love to get that burgundy Odessa. To me, this album is, there's something really cryptic and magical about it. And it manages to be very ambitious and over the top. And it borders on being pretentious, but there's enough good straight up songs that kind of keep it from going over the edge of the world, you know? And somehow it all kind of comes together. Maybe loses a little bit at the very end, which we'll talk about. But let's talk about the first track, the title track, Odessa, in parentheses, City on the Black Sea. Now, let me tell you what these lyrics are about, all right? I wrote this note because I want to get this right. Okay, so this song's about a fictitious survivor of a shipwreck of a British ship named Veronica in 1899. This is all made up. It's just the Bee Gees' imagination. So this English guy on a British ship named Veronica in 1899, he ends up on an iceberg. He's floating on this iceberg in the Baltic Sea. Okay, you got that? Well, that's what this song's about. So it's the chain of consciousness of this British guy whose ship went down on an iceberg floating in the Baltic Sea in in the late 19th century, all right? And this is a 7 minute and 33 second epic about this dude on the iceberg, all right? And which recalls and makes, you know, metaphor the Greek mythology, you know, in the Odyssey. And it's an epic, amazing song. Man, this guy, I guess musically, it's kind of like vaguely psychedelic folk pop rock. It's mainly folky. It's kind of folky sounding, but it's very English too. It's a very English folk song. I mean, this sounds like the kind of shit like Bruce Dickinson would totally like would blow him away and be like, shit, I want to do like the heavy metal equivalent of this. You know, this is like the folky version of Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, you know, and there's something kind of almost metal about it, even though it's acoustic for the most part. And it has this grandeur and majesty, and Robin's, oh, he's over the top. He's going for all the operatic worth of it. And it's really cool. And there's this quality to it that's eerie and dark and haunting, and it gets under your skin. And that's the thing. That's the thing that makes it not just feel like pretentious bullshit, is that there's real pathos to it, there's real emotion, and they feel like they tapped into something kind of dark and cosmic about it. It sounds ancient in a way. And some of the best stuff on the Beach Boy Smiles a little like that too, where they really tapped on, maybe it's certain drugs, I don't know, but they tapped into something that's almost ancient sounding about it. But I love this song. But then it gets grounded right away afterwards with You'll Never See My Face Again. Barry, a great Barry song, just a great straight up kind of folk rock number. I'd say it's kind of a folk rock song. And it's great. It's really catchy, and it just kind of grounds it. But we're not going to go all the way off the planet, off on our iceberg. We'll bring it back down to Earth again. Then Robin has another mystical great folk rock song, Black Diamond. Great song. Yeah, Black Diamond. They did a Black Diamond before Kiss did a Black Diamond. Both great songs. I love both Black Diamonds. But this Black Diamond's really great folk rock song. I'd say this is kind of a folk rock album for the most part, with a vaguely psychedelic undercurrent. Marley Pert Drive. Oh, that's such a great song. Such a great song. And this kind of a folky rock, little tinge of country to it. Song, great lyrics, funny lyrics about a guy with a lot of kids that goes to Pasadena to get away from them. And then he comes back and then he's got even more kids and decides to run an orphanage. Really clever lyrics. Bee Gees are really clever. Both Barry and Robin and Morris, as he will emerge, they're really good lyricists. They're great lyricists, and it's not something people talk a lot about them, but very clever stuff. I really like this shit. Edison's a great song. Melody Fair, great pop song. Great song on a Beatles level. Like, that's the thing. They can write melodies that are on par with Lennon McCartney melodies. These melodies are so strong. I mean, it's Melody Fair. And when you know, Melody Fair has a great melody. Suddenly's a great song. Morse sings lead on that one, and he's got, I would say the way... if I'd say Barry is kind of, I'd say soulful and like strong. That's what I think of his singing. I'd say soulful and strong. Robin is precious and regal. And Moore sounds, he's a little more rock and roll sounding than the other guys, I guess. His voice is not as distinct as Barry and Robin's voices, which is why he has probably never really emerged as a lead singer like the two of them did. But he had a kind of rock solid, good pop rock voice that could kind of ground the band and was great for their harmonies and melodies. And here he sounds almost like Roger Daltrey. He's got a little bit of a Roger Daltrey voice, but you know, it's good rock voice. And Morris also played the most instruments. This is the thing too that was emerging in the late 60s. Probably because Barry and Robin took over so much of the lead vocals, Morris compensated by being very able in bass, especially bass, amazing bassist. We'll talk more about his bass playing later, but a lot like Paul McCartney, an amazing bass player. But he also played piano, he played guitar, he did a lot of the instrumentation, especially during this period. Very talented guy. And just to make a side note, my mom, I had a similar story about Alice Cooper with my mom. My mom was a cocktail waitress in Atlantic City in the late 60s and that whole circuit up and down Jersey. And she used to always tell me the story about how she was working a mafia-owned club that was around the boardwalk of Wildwood, New Jersey, which is outside Atlantic City. And it was this club, it was a big club where Frank Sinatra played and a lot of acts. She said Little Stevie Wonder was playing there around that time. And she said the Bee Gees were this group that wasn't really that well known, this British group that came over. And they were doing some press and they performed there for like a week. And my mom was an attractive cocktail waitress working there and very young. And Morris, he talked to her a lot. He was chatting her up. According to my mom, nothing really happened between them. But she said she really liked him a lot. He seemed nice. And they talked a lot, and she kind of got a sense that if they weren't going away, like they went to England, but she goes, like, maybe something might have started between me and him, because she did like him. And so Morris went off, and then like 2 years later, he married Lulu, the pop singer. But what was interesting about the documentary I watched is after things didn't work out for Lulu, Morris married a British cocktail waitress that he met in a club in England in the mid-70s. So, and that kind of totally backed up my mom's story, like that she always told. I was just like, why wouldn't you like an attractive cocktail waitress? So anyway, so when I think of Morris too, I think of a guy who kind of impressed my mom and they kind of liked each other, but then he went off and she wasn't, you know, the type of person just to hop in someone's bed, but she liked him. And I always used to hear that story ever since I was a little kid, like that Morris from the Bee Gees. Yeah, we kind of had a little spark between us, but then he went off and that was it. And then I met your dad and then she met my father. And I guess it's a good thing because if she had hooked up with Morris, I wouldn't have existed. That's how it works. I learned this from Back to the Future, that if your mom has sex with someone else, that someone else, the child that she has is not you. It's some other kid. You won't exist. You won't exist. So that's science. It's Back to the Future science. That's how I learned that. Even though I'm sure it would have been nice to be married to Morris and been rich, at the same time, I'm glad I exist. So I'm glad it didn't happen. Because I like existing, and then I can actually listen to the Bee Gees. I couldn't listen to the Bee Gees if I didn't exist. So what album we talk about? We're talking about Odessa, still the epic album. And it's great. Whisper, Whisper's great. Lamplight, great. This song caused the Bee Gees break up. That's right. The Bee Gees broke up. And I'll tell you why in a second. Sound of Love. An amazing song. Oh my God. This song kills me. It kills me. Hits me right in the heart. Punches me in the heart. It's dark. It's a dark, beautiful ballad. Barry, man. Barry can write a fucking ballad. He could always write a ballad. That's the thing that's most consistent about their career is that Barry can write a beautiful ballad. But this is dark. It's a dark, heavy ballad. One of the most beautiful songs he ever wrote. I don't know why it wasn't a bigger hit. This song is amazing. Give Your Best is a great song. And then it does some symphony stuff, which, you know, I could give or take. It's all right. It's not bad as a segue. I Laugh in Your Face, an amazing song. One of my favorite songs from the album. Great pop rock song. Really clever, sardonic lyrics. Love it. I mean, listen, it's called I Laugh in Your Face. I Laugh in Your Face. They were such great lyricists. So underrated. Never Say Never Again. It's great. First of May. Now, this is the story. So, First of May, which is a nice pop ballad. Not one of my favorite songs on the album. I was actually surprised when I found out this was the lead-off single. I felt a lot of the others, especially Sound of Love, to me, sound like stronger songs. But it's an all right song, and it's not bad to end the album with. Then there's some instrumental after that, the British opera. But if we don't count that, this is the last proper song on the album. But so this became it's a lead vocal by just Barry, and this became this was the first single, and that really upset Robin, and he was really sad. I'm so sad, and because he wanted it to be Lamplight, his song. So there were egos, the inevitable ego clash between the two brothers, and he wanted it to be his song, and the label, and Robert went with Barry, and it was 1st of May, and Robin was pissed off, and they broke up after their greatest achievement. In my opinion, Odessa is their greatest achievement. Definitely their greatest 60s achievement. I mean, we'll get into what I think of the mid-70s stuff and how I kind of compare their various albums, but I do think this is my favorite album. That might change. There are some albums that give it a run for its money that are coming up. But I would say this right now, this is my favorite. Maybe. I don't know. It's hard. I've listened to a lot of great stuff in the past couple of weeks. But it's sad that the band would break up right. This is almost like if the Beatles broke up right after Sgt. Pepper. Because this is an amazing album. And Robin went off and did an album, which I am going to have to talk about now. Okay, we're going to talk about this now. Robin's Reign. There you go, Robin's Reign. And it did produce one hit, one UK hit, a song called Saved by the Bell, which is an all right song. I think there are better songs on this album, though. Gone, 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 that's a beautiful song. Anyway, before I get into some of the songs on this album, this, not surprising, because if you listen to Robin and the Robin sung songs, especially like I Told a Joke, if you listen to the Robin songs, you should be prepared for this to be the most twee album ever recorded. Yeah, like, this is so twee, Wes Anderson would do a double take and be like, what? This is so twee, it makes Belle and Sebastian sound like Motorhead. But there's an element of darkness and kind of like Odessa, there's a kind of undercurrent of psychedelia to it. So it's kind of creepy in a way. It's almost so twee, it's creepy. It's kind of like watching Mary Poppins on LSD. And things get a little weird, but it's still Mary Poppins. It's like a dark Mary Poppins. So this is an album. The first couple times I listened to it, I was like, this is too much for me. This is too twee for me and too much Robin. I can't handle this much Robin without breaking it up with some Barry Morris, you know? I need Barry Morris to kind of ground this shit, you know? Because he's floating off on his little castle in the clouds. But I don't know, I keep kind of, there's something about this album that does draw me in. It does have some songs that sound like they could have been on Odessa, which I really like a lot. Farmer, Ferdinand Hudson, it's a lush, somewhat psychedelic song that could have been on Odessa. And same with 1 Million a Year. My favorite song on it is The Worst Girl in This Town. It's a haunting and sounds very modern. It almost sounds like it could be like a modern indie rock song. Ghostly kind of atmosphere to it. And I really love that song a lot. And it's not bad. But it might just be a little too twee for this world, to exist in a world. It's like being bombarded with cupcakes and little China teacups while you're on acid. That's kind of what this album's like. And meanwhile, the Bee Gees, even though you wouldn't know this from the documentary, from the Frank Marshall documentary, because they just ignored this album, which is amazing, Cucumber Castle. Yeah, let's talk Cucumber Castle. 1970, man. One of my favorite Bee Gees albums. I love this album. Yeah, it's up there. It's in my top five. It's not quite as good as Odessa, but I do prefer to all the ones before Odessa. I love this album. And this is just Barry and Morris. So there you go. They don't even need Robin. Sorry, Robin. You go off on your little twee magical cloud of aristocratic sadness. And we're going to do our own thing, which is also very aristocratic. I don't know what these Bee Gees were on and what they were trying to prove in 1970. But if you look at that cover, they're really into the medieval thing. This almost looks like, what is this, power metal? the Bee Gees might have started power metal with Cucumber Castle. So anyway, they're storming the castles on this. These lads really were going out of their way to just show you how posh and aristocratic they were, which is very interesting. But so anyway, so this is this Barry. But Morris has to kind of step up. He's got to write more songs and he gets a little more involved and they're all great. And Barry's still Barry. He's still writing amazing songs. If only I had my mind on something else. Amazing song. This is almost, it's almost like easy listening, but it's great easy listening. Kind of like Burt Bacharach. And I'm a big Burt Bacharach fan. This is kind of like a Burt Bacharach song. And it's an amazing song. It's a do-do-do-do. And it has an atmosphere to it. And then they go into the song you heard at the beginning. My very favorite Bee Gees song. That's right. My favorite Bee Gees song. It's I-O. 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 Oh, oh, oh. I-O. I-O. And that's actually Morris doing, he's doing lead on the I-O's. And then Barry comes in during the verses. So this is a great Barry and Morris jam. Amazing. Such a catchy song. I don't know. This song is just like the joy of music. It's something very pure about it. It's weird because even though this album is very aristocratic and English for the most part, this song has a almost kind of an African kind of groove to it. You know, it's kind of funky, but yet pop. It's weird. It's like the two. It's like English people going into the jungle and they come out with this pop song. It's a masterpiece. It's pure music. It's pure melody. It's pure joy. This is the kind of thing that, again, I'd go to the Beatles and maybe the Beach Boys, you know, could create, specifically Paul McCartney and the Beatles, could create something that's just such pure melodic joy. Melodic joy. I love I-O, I-O. To me, it's the greatest Bee Gees song. I love this song. It just fills me, it makes me smile. When things are down, you put on I-O, I-O, and suddenly I'm up. That's great. Then You Left Me is great. Lord's great song. Great kind of folky, kind of folk rock, satirical song. Lay Down and Die. Amazing song. Great thundering drums and over-the-top romanticism to challenge Robin. Like, hey, I can get very over-the-top too and romantic. I love it. It's almost a Phil Spector-esque. I love I Lay Down and Die. Sweetheart. Amazing song. Amazing song. Very soulful. Again, a little touch of the soul. My Thing. Great song with Morris doing lead vocals. Really like that. Don't Forget to Remember, which was a hit from this album in the UK. Although the album itself did not do so well. Kind of like Robin's album. They both had one hit song from each album, but then the albums did not do so good. So, the inevitable reunion. All right, because Robin's little insurrection did not work. Did not go off and become a big star, and the Bee Gees did not become bigger without him. It was proven that they needed each other. The brothers needed to come back. So they came back, and this might explain why for the rest of his life, Robin always had a little bit of a chip on his shoulder. But hey, still did his job. He's still a pro. He's still a pro. Even if he was secretly hating his brother Barry, he was still a pro, and he sang the way he needed to sing. And so credit to him. Credit to Robin. There you go. 2 years on, an amazing album. Another amazing album. Man, goddammit, the Bee Gees are great in the late 60s and early 70s. This is one I just started to get into recently. Of course, one song on it I did know, and we'll talk about that when we get there. But 2 years on, an amazing song. I love this song. Robin does lead vocals. It's great. Amazing song. I'd say probably my favorite or second favorite on this album is the next track, Portrait of Louise. Man. Another pop rock masterpiece. Barry's just knocking them out like it ain't nothing. He's just knocking out these pop rock masterpieces. Such a catchy song. Man for All Seasons, great song. Love all this stuff. Back Home, nice rocking track. Bee Gees sometimes rocked out. They didn't do it often, but when they did a good job of it. And I like Back Home. Back Home's a good rocking track. The First Mistake I Made, amazing song. Amazing Barry ballad. I love it. Lonely Days. Now that song I did know. I remember I would hear this song from time to time and saw them perform it. It became a concert staple of theirs. But the song was never actually a big hit in its time. And it's crazy because you hear this and you go, why wasn't this a number one hit? It's like a number one hit. It's like such a catchy, memorable song. The Bee Gees obviously realized that. That's why they kept on playing it in concert. But man, this song should have been a bigger hit. It is so catchy. And this was their first single that they released as reunited brothers. So that was the whole idea, is that we were lonely without each other and now we're back together. But man, it starts off with that piano. And again, this is like Paul McCartney type shit. When it's such a level of melodic perfection. It's melodic perfection. It builds up and hits that chorus, one of the catchiest choruses you'll ever hear. And it's soulful. Again, you hear soul in this. So this idea that the Bee Gees, ooh, shocked everyone because they were so white and suddenly they got so black with Main Chorus and the Saturday Night Fever stuff. Well, you know, if you were really listening here and there, the Bee Gees, especially some of the Barry stuff, they had their soulful moments, you know, and this is one of them. It's Lonely Days, to me, sounds like a soul song. Amazing song. It's a great album. I love 2 years on. Not quite as good as the last two, but it's up there. It's up there. It's a really good album. And then we get to 1971's Trafalgar. Trafalgar, 1971. An amazing album. In fact, this is might be my second favorite Bee Gees album after Odessa. And in a lot of ways, this is similar to Odessa. It's kind of a more scaled back, slightly less ambitious Odessa. An amazing album. And this is the album that actually Jimmy James, he posted a song about a month ago on Facebook. It's Just the Way. Jimmy James, that's what got me on this Bee Gees kick. That song, It's Just the Way, and it's a Morris song. I didn't even know that. I thought it was Barry singing. It's Morris's greatest vocal performance ever. It's great. And this song just blew me away. And I immediately bought the album like from the Apple Store. And it's amazing. I don't know why wasn't I listening to this for years? It's an amazing album. It's like, where have you been all my life? I did know the hit song from it. The first song, How Can You Mend a Broken Heart? Their first number one hit in the States. Not a big hit in the UK. It's weird. The fickle UK public, they didn't care that the Bee Gees kept throwing great songs at them. They were like, Bee Gees, you're so 2 years ago. They didn't care. But in the U.S. weren't oversaturated with the Bee Gees yet, so they were like, okay, we'll take that song. That's a great early 70s, mellow, soft rock ballad. It's great. It's kind of easy listening again, but great, amazing, easy listening. Almost a little like kind of foreshadows Barry Manilow a little bit. It's an amazing song, though. It's also like Burt Bacharach. It sounds like an instant standard, How Can You Mend a Broken Heart? A beautiful song. Robin and Barry both trading off lead vocals. They both sing great on this song. It's an amazing song. Then we got Barry's of Israel, great kind of folky rock song. Love that song. And then It's Just the Way, my favorite song on the album. One of my favorite Bee Gees songs, the one that Jimmy James posted that got me into this Bee Gees madness. It's a strong, strong rock ballad. That's what I'd call it. It almost, the guitar line reminds me of Jimi Hendrix's Hey Joe. It sounds like Morris was kind of ripping off Hey Joe, but turned it into his own kind of song about breaking up with a woman. It's got amazing guitar line, amazing singing, his best lead vocal ever, I think. So good that I thought it was Barry at first. And it's a great song. I love It's Just the Way. That's great. The title track, which is also sung by Morris, and probably his second best lead vocal job, is Trafalgar. Amazing song. And this is like Morris's Odessa, you know? And it's a great song. And if you know, for people who aren't hip to their English history, Trafalgar, and this is depicted, it's in the album cover, it's the 1805 Battle of Trafalgar. It's in which the British Royal Navy defeated the French and Spanish navies during the Napoleonic Wars. So there you go. Again, this is like kind of shit that you would think Bruce Dickinson might want to sing about in Iron Maiden. They were into like the history, the English history. So there you go. Early 19th century Navy battle. And here we go. The Bee Gees made a song about it. This haunting, beautiful, epic. I love this song. Morris is great on it. But then we get to easily my second favorite song on this album. And one of my favorite Bee Gees tracks, Don't Wanna Live Inside Myself. Barry Gibb song again. Man, Barry Gibb knocks these songs out. This is one of the most beautiful, haunting, and dark ballads you ever want to hear. This is a song almost sounds like a Morrissey or Smith song. It's very ahead of its time. If you want to hear how dark it is, listen to these lyrics, like in the verses. I went walking through a graveyard where the darkness is my friend. You know, that's like goth shit. Barry's getting all goth. Don't want to live inside myself. Oh, man, it's so powerful. It also kind of makes me think of some of, like, the darker Brian Wilson stuff, like on Surf's Up or Pet Sounds, you know? Like, I just wasn't made for these times. It's dark, it's haunting, it's powerful. It's a powerful song. I love this song. It sounds timeless, you know? You think about this. This was recorded in 1971, but it could be any time. It could be today. It's a dark, powerful, moving ballad. One of the greatest Bee Gees songs I love it. And it's because of that, the title track, It's Just the Way, How Do You Mend a Broken Heart, all these great songs, you know, adds up to, this is a masterpiece. This is another masterpiece, like Odessa. Lion in Winter is a really cool song, strong drumming, again, kind of this weird primal British thing going on, like they're getting into the id of being English, you know, Walking Back to Waterloo. This is a masterpiece, one of their best albums. I love it. If you like English pop rock, you gotta listen to Trafalgar. Man, is it good. Man. Let me drink a little more cognac. All right, let's do it, man. What's next? 1972. To Whom It May Concern. I like it. I like it. So hold on, Bee Gees fans, if you're getting ready to rumble. I do like it. But I have to say, I think this is the weakest album from their early period. If we're considering their early period, and this is kind of the end of it, from Bee Gees' first to this album, then this is the weakest. But it's still good. It's still a good, solid Bee Gees album. It's interesting because it's kind of like, musically, it's kind of like what you would think from the album cover. When you look at that album cover, you go, well, that's not that interesting. It's just the Bee Gees. Well, that's kind of like the music inside. It's like it's just more the Bee Gees. Like everything that you've been used to hearing the Bee Gees do from 67 on is kind of covered on this album. With the exception of maybe one song, which we'll get to, everything here is kind of like stuff they've done before. Nothing really new, nothing really revelatory, but it's all good. It's all good, solid British pop rock. Run to Me is a very pretty song. I really love Paper Mache, Cabbages and Kings. That's a good kind of British pop rock ditty. There's One Rocker, which is cool. Bad, Bad Dreams. Always like to hear a rare Bee Gees rocker. The last song is my favorite song on the album. Although, no, I also like Road to Alaska. That's a good rocking tune with Robin singing, showing that Robin could sometimes do a kind of bluesier, more rocking kind of vocal. A little unusual for him, but he can do it. But the last song, Sweet Song of Summer. I love this song, and it's kind of a psychedelic pop rock song, but it's utilizing a synthesizer. So that gives it kind of a more modern sound than the rest of the album. It's a fat-sounding synthesizer, too. It comes on really fat-sounding, and that's like the one foreshadowing of maybe where the Bee Gees might go a little bit. But the rest of this album all just sounds like we're kind of just playing it safe. It's a good album. I don't dislike it, and maybe it'll grow on me. But right now, I would say if we're considering their first phase to be Bee Gees' first to this album, then this is, you kind of understand why they thought they needed to change directions. Because this feels a little bit like a dead end. You know, hey, most artists couldn't do a dead end this good, but it still is a dead end, you know, especially after Trafalgar, which is so much better in this album, in my opinion. But this is all right. It's just kind of safe and a creative dead end. So, you know, if you have all the others, you might as well get this too, but don't expect it to blow you away. Okay, so then we get to 1973, Life in a Tin Can. Now, this is the one thing. Now we're going to be talking about a lot of shit, not just Odessa and Cucumber Castle, but we're going to talk about some other shit that the Frank Marshall documentary didn't talk about. And I understand why they did what they got to do. They only got 2 hours, and they got to focus on like the big albums and the things where the Bee Gees made the biggest cultural impact. Someone who works in the film industry, I understand why they had to do what they did. So, and it's a really well put together documentary, so I do recommend watching it. But as a hardcore, now that I'm a hardcore Bee Gees fan, there are things I wish they would have dived a little more into. And one thing I understand why they did it, but they did, was they kind of ignored 2 albums. In 73 and 74, they just referred to them in passing as 2 albums that weren't successful. But they kind of don't explain the history of the Bee Gees and how these were attempts to change their sound. They kind of make it seem like Main Course, in the documentary, they make it kind of seem like Main Course is their first attempt to really change their sound. But it kind of started here. Like, I don't consider Life in a Tin Can part of their classic original era. Like, that to me end it with the last album, To Whom It May Concern. To me, Life in a Tin Can was an attempt to go in a different direction, and it didn't work. You know, it's like a failed attempt because it's different from all their other past albums. It's more, it's kind of, which makes sense if you look at 73, it's an attempt to go a little more singer-songwriter, kind of stripped back country. It's a little country. It's got a little more country pop folk. And yes, they had this side in a few songs here and there before, which I point out they were a little country, but never as stripped back as this. There's the definite, it's almost like an unplugged album with a little bit of orchestration here and there. Like the first song, Saw a New Morning, has some symphony and a very vaguely psychedelic rock holdover, if you hear with some guitar feedback here and there on a few songs. But for the most part, this is obviously them trying to be a little more stripped back. Like if you look at the time, a lot of Southern California rock, early Eagles, Neil Young Harvest, James Taylor, Linda Ronstadt, that kind of stuff was very popular in the early 70s. So it sounds like they're trying to hitch their wagon, like maybe this is where the Bee Gees are going to go. Obviously it's not. But it kind of, it's like their attempt to do kind of their version of a early 70s Southern California kind of folky country album. And it's interesting that they did, and this is really the only album like this. So if you ever want to hear them do it, it's a nice, I like it. I like it better than the last one. It's not great. I understand why this didn't do it for them, you know, but the album failed and no one really liked this direction. But there's some really good songs. I like the first one. Saw a New Morning. Love South Dakota Morning. Great country song. Great country song from Barry Gibb. Really moving. Like a little John Denver-esque. Like that. Living in Chicago is a good tune. Come Home Johnny Birdie. Another good song. Method to My Madness is a cool song. I like this album. I like this album. It's a good Sunday morning kind of album. If you want to listen to a cool Sunday morning album and them doing kind of more stripped back country fried kind of stuff. Life in a Tin Can is an interesting album and a good album, but I can kind of hear why it didn't quite connect with people. So then, and this is probably the biggest, next to not talking about Dessa, the second biggest oversight, I think, of the Frank Marshall documentary is not talking about Mr. Natural. 1974 is Mr. Natural. Now, the thing about this album is, this is the first time they worked with Arif Mardin. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Arif Mardin. He was a legendary producer for a lot of soul acts and R&B acts on Atlantic Records. And they drafted him in to kind of help reimagine the Bee Gees. Like, the Bee Gees is like, oh, okay, that country stuff didn't work, and your old British pop stuff's not working, and, you know, that kind of stuff's not working anymore. So we got to figure it out. But, you know, RSO, they were committed. So they get Arif Mardin in to kind of funk them up a little bit, and they think, okay, so that didn't work, but let's try to get him to make the Bee Gees sound more modern. It was not Main Course. It was this album. This is the first album he produced with them. In the documentary, they did mention in passing that he did one other album with them, which was this album, but they didn't go into details about it because this album was not successful. As a result, this album is largely forgotten by people, and it's a shame because it's one of their greatest albums. I love this album, and this is an album I had heard once or twice before, but I never owned it until recently. But man, this is one of the albums I've been listening to the most in the past month. I love this album, and it's very important to their evolution as artists. And you wouldn't have Main Course if you didn't have this album first. But it is different. It's not full-fledged. This is not disco-era Bee Gees. What's important about this album is this is the true, what I'd call a transition album. It's like a Rubber Soul and Revolver, you know, between the early Beatles and the later Beatles. Like, you need to have that transition album. And the Bee Gees had a transition album. This is the true transition album from their earlier phase, their pop rock phase, into their more R&B-oriented disco phase. This is the album that's the transition album between those two eras. So in a lot of ways, it's kind of like the definitive Bee Gees album. Like, this is, if I was to play one person, one Bee Gees album, and say, this is what the Bee Gees are all about, it'd be this album. And it's funny because most people don't even know it. Because this is the one where it kind of all comes together. And it's solid. Every song's great on it. And this sounds like a new Bee Gees. They're not all the way there yet. That would be the next album, Main Course. But they're halfway there. And it's obviously new. There's still elements of the old band there. But they're definitely updating it for the mid-70s, and you hear it instantly in the production, and the electric piano, Charade, great song, kind of jazzy, great song, electric piano. You could hear the production that they're kind of moving in that direction. The next two tracks, which are really one big epic track put together, Throw a Penny, Slash Down the Road, even though they do split them up as two different tracks. They really are one track. Throw a Penny's an amazing pop rock song. Modern 70s production, but a classic pop rock Bee Gees composition that could have been in their late 60s as well. But then when it goes into Down the Road, that's where it's going into something different. Hell, these two songs alone show the transition. You know, it's kind of like this is the microcosm of the whole album. Throw a Penny going into Down the Road. It's like Throw the Penny is like where they were, and then Down the Road is where they're going. And maybe that's even intentional. Now that I'm saying the lyrics, the titles right there sound like it might be intentional. Down the Road, it's funky. Funky in a way we haven't heard the Bee Gees yet. It's rocking too, a little more hard rocking than they've been, but it's funky, it's soulful. There's almost kind of a gospel groove to it. This is where Barry really gets the swagger. He's got a swagger in his voice. And the groove is there, and you're like, this is it. This is like the beginning. This is the beginning of main course funky era Bee Gees. I prefer saying funky era than disco era. Bee Gees is really on Down the Road. And then Voice is a great song. Give a Hand, Take a Hand is a great song. They're all great. My favorite song, Throw a Penny and Down the Road, which I kind of think of as one song. But then I'd say Dogs. Dogs is an amazing pop rock song. Again, kind of like their older stuff, but a little more 70s, a little more hard rocking actually in spots. And another thing I want to mention with this album is not only was it the first time Arif Mardin worked for them, it's Alan Kendall. I'm going to get this right. Yeah, Alan Kendall played lead guitar. Alan Kendall on lead guitar. He would go on to play lead guitar on all their big late 70s albums and hits. Like he's playing the lead guitar and Staying Alive, that iconic guitar riff. Is this guy. He's an amazing guitarist, an unsung guitarist that should get more attention. And he's great on this album. And you hear his leads, like there's more electric guitar leads on this album that add a punch to the poppy material. And Dogs is an amazing song. Amazing song. Another great Barry Gibb song. Man, this guy knocks shit out. He's like Paul McCartney. He just knocks this shit out. Mr. Natural, great song. Love that song. I Can't Let You Go, beautiful song. Heavy Breathing, Hard Rocker, that's a good one of the more hard rocking songs. That's good, but also a little funky. Had a Lot of Love Last Night, great song. It's great. You could kind of hear also that Barry is beginning to really dominate the band here. And that would be a trend that follows into the late 70s. And it's a great album. And I would recommend it, especially if you like just mid-70s kind of pop rock. If you love shit like Elton John's Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and Hunky Chateau. If you like also like mid-70s Wings, like Band on the Run and Venus and Mars, if you like that kind of shit, like Wings and Elton John, then I would definitely recommend Mr. Natural. I think it's this unsung masterpiece. It's one of their greatest albums. I don't know. Sometimes like I say Odessa and Trafalgar, this might be their best album. This might be my favorite album. I'm still a little new to this, but this album is amazing. It's an amazing album. It's a masterpiece. It's a mid-70s masterpiece, and it's sad that it's unsung because it's a very important album for their musical evolution, and it's just chock full of great songs, great melodies, great musicianship, great production. Everything's working. It's amazing that everything's working, and it still didn't land, but I can kind of get why. It's not as a radical reinvention as the next one. That's the thing. It's a transitional album. And unless you were already with the band for that transition, like the Beatles, then it's not enough yet. It's halfway there, but it's not all the way enough for a public that has kind of cooled on them. They stuck it out with Arif Mardin. So obviously they knew something was cooking. Something was happening here. And they kept like this new band that they got. And they tried it again. They won in the studio again with this new band and producer, and this is when it clicked. And this is the shit that you'll find out all about if you watch the Frank Marshall documentary. I always loved this album. This is actually one of the few Bee Gees albums that I'm talking about now that I've lived with for a long time, that I've had for a long time. And for a long time, I made the mistake of thinking this was kind of summing up. Like, I kind of felt like Odessa summed them up in the 60s, and this summed them up in the 70s. And I do think this is maybe, it's this or Mr. Natural. One of these is their greatest album of the 70s. Maybe it's this one. I don't know. It's amazing. It's an amazing album. Yes, Main Course is an amazing album. 1975. You know some of the songs from this album, especially Jive Talkin'. That's the really big hit from this album. But this whole album is great. They relocated to Miami, and they were really focusing, let's really go into this R&B thing. Let's get really funky. Let's really embrace a new sound. Although there's still a few elements here and there that, you know, it's not all just funk and disco. It's actually a very eclectic record, and we're going to talk about this song by song. But this is probably, might be their best production ever. It's up there with some of the best, like, Eagles and Fleetwood Mac productions of the mid-70s. It's an amazing production, and you hear it right out of the gate, Nights on Broadway. Of course, that was a hit song, too. It's funky. It's great. I love that song. Jive Talkin', one of my favorite Bee Gees songs. There was a period, one part about my musical evolution with the Bee Gees were involved that I didn't talk about was, as a kid, you know, my mom played the greatest hits all the time. So yeah, I was very familiar with Jive Talkin' and all the songs that were on the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. But, you know, as I became a teenager and got into heavy metal and hard rock, you know, I wasn't listening to the Bee Gees anymore. But one thing that happened was, after high school, I had a rock band that I started, because I was a bassist, I got very into funk. You know, it makes sense because what electric guitar is for heavy metal and hard rock, bass is for funk. Like, it's like the main instrument. It's like the lead instrument in funk. It drives a lot of the songs. So I found myself, as I got better on bass, I found myself growing more and more interested in funk music and R&B. And that's when I started to get into, and I talked a bit about this on my Marvin Gaye video and some of my Prince videos. That's when I start to get into that kind of stuff. And at the same time, I start to remember a lot of disco because my mom loved disco. She was a big disco person. And along with the Bee Gees' greatest hits, she had the on the radio Donna Summer's greatest hits. She used to play that a lot. So in my very formative years as a young, you know, as a young man, as a young child, as a wee lad, as a little boy, I heard a lot of disco in my house. So, but I hadn't listened to it much as a teenager, you know, that wasn't what I was going to be interested in as a teenager. But especially when I was like, I think I was like in my early 20s and I moved to New York, my band, which at that point was a funk band, a full-on funk band. I was diving into all this stuff. And at this point, I bought the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. I had the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack and I listened to that a lot. And my band, we used to play Disco Inferno. It was a good warm-up song for us and I loved that bass line. But I always loved that bass line. From Jive Talkin', that was the thing. I would listen to this and go, damn, you know, the Bee Gees, they ain't fluffy. That's a straight up funky bass line. That bass line could be on a Parliament song. That could be Bootsy Collins. And that's Morris, man. Morris Gibb, an amazing bassist. Amazing bassist. That bass line on Jive Talkin', man, and he's using that cool ass effect. That cool ass effect. I had a pedal. I had a Boss bass pedal that had that effect. And I remember the first time I hit it, I was like, oh, fuck, it's the Jive Talkin' sound. And I loved it. I wrote a couple songs around that sound. And man, that Jive Talkin' bass line, that is some next level shit. And Morris, and he was playing the same kind of bass I had, my very favorite bass of all time, the Rickenbacker. Rickenbacker was an awesome bass. And I remember seeing the clips of them doing Jive Talkin', and Morris is there on the Rickenbacker. And the Rickenbacker, another great funk bassist, Rick James, he played the Rickenbacker. Paul McCartney used the Rickenbacker. And Lemmy! God damn it, Lemmy used the Rickenbacker. So that digression about the Rickenbacker and Morris Gibb being an amazing funky bassist aside, that's when I got really into Jive Talkin'. And I think I got this album at some point too. But for whatever reason, I never really dived into their other stuff. But this album still holds up. It's an amazing album. Wind of Change, great. It's kind of their first full-on disco song. That's a disco song, but a great disco song. I like a lot of disco, so nothing wrong with that. Fanny. Whoa. Fanny, Be Tender With My Love, one of their best songs. I love this song. It's a pop rock masterpiece. It's a pop ballad. Kind of soulful. It's kind of both R&B and a pop ballad, kind of in one. This is where Barry really starts utilizing the falsetto, the famous falsetto, and he makes it to great use. You know, I used to sing in a falsetto too in my funk band. You can't be in a funk band and not do a falsetto. But Fanny, Be Tender With My Love, beautiful song, funky, soulful. It's like Curtis Mayfield shit, and these white British guys are doing it, man. They're nailing it. I love that song. All This Making Love, a good kind of, you know, it's a rock song. It's kind of like an Elton John Wings sounding hard rock song. Love that. Country Lanes, nice bout. Come On Over, a country song. You're still doing some country shit. And it's a great country song. Olivia Newton-John would cover the song later on and make a hit, country hit out of it. Edge of the Universe, another kind of rock song that has a hint, a little hint of psychedelia, a little hint of the old Bee Gees. This album is more eclectic than you would realize. It's kind of hailed as this is the R&B album, and this is the album where that begins the disco era, but it's really an eclectic album that definitely moves them in a new direction, but it's like a full course meal. You know, it's the main course. It's the main course, man. You get everything with this album, and it's why it's one of their greatest albums. Then we get to Children of the World, weakest album of the 70s. Yeah, big drop off. Yeah, big drop off. It's funny because they made kind of a meal of how Arif Mardin couldn't produce this album. Well, and you can hear it. It does. It has, of course, one big hit, You Should Be Dancing. That's a great funky disco song. You know, it's a more great use of Barry's falsetto. You know, you should be dancing, hey! Good song, funky. Love So Right's a nice ballad. You know, it's not horrible. Boogie Child's a little corny. Sounds kind of like them doing a shitty disco song. Overall, it's not a bad album. Maybe it'll grow on me. I haven't really lived with it too long. But I just feel like it feels like they kind of rushed us out because of the success of Main Chorus. Because, by the way, I didn't mention Main Chorus and Jive Talking. Jive Talking was like a number one hit in the States. It blew up. It blew up, and it made the Bee Gees huge stars in America. And Children of the World sounds like an album that they kind of rushed out to capitalize on that. And it's all right, but it's a little schlocky. It's a little what I imagine people think that don't like the Bee Gees think their albums probably sound like. They probably think they sound more like this, the Main Course. So it's a little corny, a little schlocky, a little rushed, not horrible. Maybe it'll grow on me. But right now I'm saying of all these albums that I'm reviewing, this is the weakest. And it's a big drop off after Main Course. But because of You Should Be Dancing, that's kind of keeping them in the game. And then, yeah, it's a Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. Now, not officially a Bee Gees album. It's a soundtrack album. But, you know, their songs, they have a handful of new songs on this album that were all big hits. And they're on the cover. I mean, look, there they are with John Travolta. So, you know, obviously I got to talk about the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. You know, since my childhood to even my early 20s funk years, this was an important album in my life. It's all great, even the non-Bee Gees songs, but the Bee Gees songs are the best. And Staying Alive, man, what can you say? It's that guitar riff, those drums, which apparently from the documentary, it's a drum loop. It's like hip-hop. That's great. It's one of the greatest songs ever written. It's a classic. Barry's falsettos just keeps getting better and better. It's jivey, it's strutting. You can't listen to this song without thinking of either John Travolta or the Bee Gees in that promotional video, strutting down the street. And it's the ultimate swagger song. It's generally funky and cool, and it's amazing that white boys can get that funky. I love it. How Deep Is Your Love, though? Perfect, beautiful, timeless ballad. And that's the thing. Bee Gees and Barry could always write an amazing ballad. Didn't matter. This is the thing that links all their eras together. And to me, How Deep Is Your Love? Yeah, the production with the electric piano and the production's very 70s. But this song's just like a standard to me. This is like Yesterday or like Here, There, and Everywhere. Like, this is just a classic, beautiful love song. It's one of the most beautiful love songs ever written. And no matter how many times I hear How Deep Is Your Love, it still stirs something. It still stirs something. There's not that much playout factor to it, which is amazing considering how many times I've heard this song ever since I was a child. It's one of the greatest love songs and most beautiful and moving love songs ever written. Barry and the keyboardist got choked up just talking about writing the song, you know? And you could understand why when you hear this song. It's an amazing song. Night Fever, catchy as hell. Love the production. Love the vocals. Great song. More Than a Woman. Another great song that they wrote that they didn't sing on this album, but they do sing on the greatest hits. I remember that being on the greatest hits that my mom had. If I Can't Have You, amazing song. And these songs were amazing. And it definitely was like, if you thought they were slipping on Children of the World, they were like, nah, we're getting right back in the pocket again. They got back in the pocket again, and they're doing stuff on a Main Course level again. And these songs are amazing, and it definitely set up the next album, 1979's Spirits Having Flown. Spirits Having Flown. This album cover is weird. I talked about this on Facebook. I kept trying to sharpen it for my music library, and it, no matter how much I sharpen it, it always kept its weird, blurry 70s soft focus. Look, if you stare at that album cover, it gives you a headache. It's soft. It's weird. It's 70s soft focus on an album cover. And there's something, I don't know, like I think the Bee Gees were warlocks that practiced disco sex magic. That's what that album cover is to me. It's evil. It's evil, but it's funky and sexy at the same time. So this album, definitely better than Children of the World. Definitely better than that album. Not as strong overall as Main Course, in my opinion, or Mr. Natural, or, you know, some of those earlier albums that I love. But it's a solid pop rock album. If you like the Saturday Night Fever stuff, this is probably this and Main Course are the two albums that are closest to that level, you know, to that sound and to that level of songwriting. Tragedy, of course, is an amazing song, almost ABBA-esque. And it definitely has a disco production, and there's elements of disco on this album, but it sounds to me like they were already here in 79, saw the writing on the wall. There's a little bit of a shift away, a little bit. Even in Tragedy, like it has some disco horns and a little bit of funkiness in the chorus, but it's a little more of a 79 pop rock song. You know, there's the guitar element in the verses. I don't know. Like I said, it's more like an ABBA-esque pop rock song more than a disco song, in my opinion. And you can say that for a lot of this album. Too Much Heaven, just another beautiful ballad. Maybe not quite on the level of How Deep Is Your Love, but not that far from it. Another classic ballad, beautiful song, beautiful harmonies. Barry's falsetto, he's utilizing it not just to be funky, but to sing soulful, beautiful ballads. It's great stuff, you know. Also, like Delphonics, I'm a huge Delphonics fan. And songs like this, they remind me of the Delphonics, you know, so that's great. Love You Inside Out, funky song. Good funky, kind of more of a funk song than a disco song, in my opinion. Just kind of a smooth, funky song, kind of like something Marvin Gaye might have done. I really love that. I'm Satisfied, it's cool. I like the last song, Until, it's kind of cool, a little synthy. Kind of leans a little more towards the mellow ballad side than the funky side, but for the most part, a solid pop rock album, a slight, perhaps too slight, move away from disco to just kind of general pop rock and soulful ballads. But it's a solid album, and it might even grow on me more in the coming years. But I do like it. I do like it and think it's solid. And now, we're going to get to the last album I'm talking about. So here we go. 1981's Living Eyes. And this is an album my wife hit me to. She said, I think you'll like it because I really love my favorite Eagles album is their last one, The Long Run. And she said, it's kind of like the Bee Gees' Long Run. And by that, she means it's kind of a darker pop rock album that has this kind of early 80s sound that's kind of like the end of the road. You know, in a lot of ways, it's kind of what like the Rolling Stones' Goathead Soup is, which, and that's my favorite Rolling Stones album. Yes, it's official. I on my Goathead Soup review, I was struggling with this, but I'm finally admitting it. It's no longer Exile Main Street. My favorite Stones album is Goathead Soup. So there you go. So, and that's kind of the end of a party album too. You know, there's these albums that are kind of dark, but poppy, but dark albums that mark like the end of an era, and they're kind of the hangover album or like the dark end of the party album. And that's the thing about The Long Run for the Eagles is like, this is it. We're done. We're on the verge of breaking up. The fast lane is days are done and it's coming down in a sad cloud of coke and egos clashing. I love that shit. Anyway, so this is an album that has that vibe. And it's definitely not a disco album. There are definitely, by this point, Disco Sucks movement had kind of heard a lot of disco records and artists, and the Bee Gees got all caught up in it. Even though I agree with the Bee Gees, I don't think they ever were a purely disco act, but because they were the poster boys for Saturday Night Fever, and that was the disco movie, and they had some disco hits, obviously they were associated with that movement. And as a result, it hurt their career in a very big way. Even though at first it made their career, took it to another level, but then, you know, came down. And this album is obviously a big step away. If Spirits Having Flown moved a little bit away from disco, this took a much bigger step. Although it still has a little of that hangover, still say kind of a Giorgio Moroder kind of vibe to it, atmosphere to the recording. So it doesn't sound entirely removed from disco, even though it's not disco music. You know, it reminds me a little of the, you know, American Gigolo or Scarface soundtracks. It has a little of that vibe. And also, like I said, the Eagles' Long Run. But it's subtle. It's not the kind of album that hits you right away, but the more you listen to it, this album's been probably the one that's been increasing the most in my estimation of it. I love this title track, Living Eyes. That's a great song. He's a Liar. Awesome song. Really cool video. Really dark. You should check that out. Morris kills a woman in it. It's pretty dark shit. And the song's dark. They sound, it's almost like, in their own weird way, it's like Bee Gees metal. You know? With the guitar line and the way they sing the chorus. He's a liar. He's a liar. He's a liar. It's like, they sound angry. They sound really angry in it. And I guess they were angry. If you've seen Barry doing interviews around this time, he's really pissed off that the fickle public wasn't loving the Bee Gees anymore. And I feel like they put the anger in the song, especially the chorus. It's probably the angriest the Bee Gees ever sounded. And it's funky and cool. I love the synth on it. It's a dark, catchy synth pop song with kind of a dark heavy metal spirit, even though it's more synth pop. But I really love the vibe and the chorus. I love that song. Paradise, beautiful song. My wife loves this song. I love this song too. Another beautiful ballad. Barry and Robin sing on it. It's just another beautiful ballad. They can always just knock out these beautiful ballads. That's the thing the Bee Gees always do. And Paradise is a beautiful song. Soldiers is a cool song. Wildflowers, cool song. They're bringing a little more of a pop rock element than they have had since probably Mr. Natural. That's cool. Again, a little, if you like stuff like Paul McCartney from like the early 80s or ABBA from like the early 80s, if you like that, or the Eagles, if you like shit like that, then you'd probably like this album too. Crying Every Day is a great song. Probably some of my favorite Robin vocals ever. Robin sounds actually really funky on this song, and it's really great. Like the synth on that. Be Who You Are starts off with orchestra, and then it's a beautiful ballad by Barry, another dark, beautiful, heavy ballad. This is the swan song, and this feels like a good way to wrap things up. And I would say Living Eyes, I went from thinking it was a good album to a very good album. Today, I'm convinced it's a great album. It's subtle, but it creeps in there. There's something meaningful about it. It's definitely my favorite album after Main Course, but I don't know. I feel like this might be Goathead Soup. This might be an album which maybe I'm not prepared to say it yet, but it wouldn't surprise me if a year or two from now, because I was like this with The Long Run too. That used to not be my favorite Eagles album, but now it is. It wouldn't surprise me if a year or two from now, I'm saying Living Eyes is my favorite Bee Gees album. You know, I'm not there yet. Hey, this is Future Edwin. And Future Edwin says, Living Eyes is the greatest Bee Gees album ever. It's a dark, unsung masterpiece, man. I love this album. It's their best. Right now, just saying it's great, best after Main Course. Not ready to say it's their best yet, but I might one day. We'll see. We'll see. Definitely check it out. Check out that album. All right, I'm pretty liquored now. I'm probably more liquored than those English gentlemen after they get pissed discussing how they should stop the monsters. You know, it's interesting because when they go off to fight the monsters, they're probably all really pissed by that point. And that's what you got to do. I mean, think about it. If you're an English gentleman and you got to go fight a vampire or a Frankenstein monster or something, or, you know, whatever, you know, you're going to want to be a little drunk for that, you know? Just like you want to be a little drunk when you spend 2 hours talking about the bloody Bee Gees. But they're a great band. If you love bands like the Beatles and ABBA and Oasis and the Kinks and the Beach Boys and the Bee Gees, then you should definitely listen to the Bee Gees. And there's a lot more to the Bee Gees than just Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. They're an eclectic band, great band, Barry Gibb, genius. Genius songwriter. Up there, Paul McCartney and Brian Wilson, in my opinion. Yeah, I said it. I think the guy was genius. And Morris, very unsung, talented guy. And Robin, hey, I like to make fun of Robin, but he was very talented too. Real tender bravado. These guys, they were the real deal. They were major talents of late 20th century music. And it's cool shit. Listen to it, man. Cheers. All done.